Ladies and gentlemen, please, for now, I'm having the honor of inviting Dr. Garbsak Pudragoon, Director and Senior Executive Vice President, Bangkok Bank Public Company Limited, on the stage. Please welcome.
Today, they invite me to talk on the topic of futuristic Asia-Pacific. Welcome to the futures. I've been thinking about what I will be talking for some time, but I would remember that every morning, when we wake up, we always have high hope for today, right? We hope that today will be a great day, will be a bright future, we will get so many things done, and there will be many exciting developments. But I have a news. I think the future waiting for us over the next couple years will be very challenging. Will be both good news and bad news, both challenges and also opportunities. So I would like to tell you my vision of what will be happening over the next couple years. How can we prepare for such eventualities? Usually, the future is not easy to forecast, but I talked to them before. If there are some problem, bring me the mic. Okay, we don't know what will be happening, but we are starting to see the glimpse of what waiting for us. If we are early in the year 2022, we might not see exactly what will be happening, but 8 months passed, 9 months passed already. We already see exactly all the forces are already in places. And they have been playing out over the past 9 months. And what happening over the past 9 months will start to roll out over the next couple years and will become one of the greatest challenges in terms of economics. Now, the year 2022 and 2025 will be the key turning point for the world economies. We are already standing there, 9 months passed into the years. We hope that we will move from COVID-19 into the new normal, new chapters. Remember every time in the past 2 years, we've been talking about when COVID leaves, what we can do, right? We're planning to travel, we're planning to do business, we're planning to do so many things. We can see bright future in front of us after COVID leaving. But what people don't aware is that between the two, there will be a transition. And what people don't aware of is that this transition will be quite long. This is the bad news I will be telling you. Usually we thought that maybe a couple months, maybe half a year, maybe 1 year, and then we'll come out to the new normal, the next chapter, where we can enjoy our life and then we can do so many things. But turned out to be that the transition phase has been quite challenging and also will be quite good length of almost 3 years. And in fact, I choose this picture for you. And last night, I take a look at the IMF website. They have the World Economic World Economic Outlook, the picture they choose is exactly the same. They have the storm coming. And this will be one of the greatest economic crises that we are experiencing over the past 80 years. The challenge will have 7 dimensions. I will go very briefly, but I will very focusing on the key development in terms of what happened in terms of economics. We have three continent of problems. Russia, Ukraine, US, the Fed, China, right? We have problem in terms of geopolitics, global energy crisis, global food crisis. We have volatility in the capital markets. We also have recession coming in the US and the rest of the countries. Emerging market crisis is brewing, and also China, which usually to be very important country that become the buy of last resort. Every crisis, China buy it all. During 2008, we can send product to China. During COVID, we also send product to China. But this crisis, China is also enter into its own crisis. So this is exactly why people said this is a perfect storm, because it coming all together from small pieces, but working together become to be a big storm. Now, let me show you what has been happening. In the first 6 months of this year, you can see that investors don't have a good time. In fact, they've been telling me that this is the investment storm. They have been living in the capital market for many years, but this is the biggest investment storm ever. Because no matter where they put the money coming down. The stock coming down, crypto coming down, the bond market coming down, gold coming down, exchange rate, except the US, is coming down. So basically, Dow Jones came down almost now, well, more than 16-17% already. NASDAQ, 30%. This is the largest drop since the beginning of NASDAQ in 6 months. And it's not the end. This is just the beginning. And if you look further, you can see that Dow Jones, which dropped and then increased from 6,000 to 18,000, is now back to pre-COVID level already. In fact, below pre-COVID level. What does that mean? It means that all the bubble that the Fed has been putting the QE on has gone, right? Gone. And in fact, NASDAQ is following. S&P 500 is also coming down as well. But let me show you one more picture. This is DAX, German Stock Exchange. Before COVID, coming down, QE, but look what happened. It's coming down and now it dropped probably roughly about 15% below peak before COVID time. This is the extent of the problem that we are facing at this point in time. And I'm not showing you the picture of Bitcoin, right? Because that will be quite damaging to the heart. But all of this picture has been hurting the investor all 9 months. Last night, IMF came out with this forecast. But take a look. From 6% in 2021, now they are forecasting 2.7 for 2023. This is the fourth reduction in terms of forecast that they have already made. But I'm telling you, from my experience as an economist, this is probably not the end of the reduction in terms of forecasting. They probably take it down even further as time progressing on, because the model cannot capture crisis well. When you are enter into the crisis mode, model over-predict, and as time passes by, it will coming down and coming down. So by mid of next year, I think this number will be substantially reduced. But take a look on what's happening. America, 1%. Europe, 0.5%. Latin America, 1.7%. What does it mean? It means that if you take the whole number down, 1% probably becomes zero, right? Maybe negative. Europe, definitely recession. Caribbean is also facing the same problem. And in fact, if you look at the breakdown of the forecast, you can see things that is not usually happen. Negative number in terms of growth rate. You can see that, in fact, they are now forecasting that Germany will be negative 0.3%. Italy, negative 0.2%. And, of course, Russia, negative 2.3%. But many more of 0.3, 0.7, 0.5. So what does this mean? This means that all the economy around the world is now on the brink of recession, right? For next years. And that's exactly the bad news I'm telling you. Good news. We should break with some good news, right? This is Asia. Probably will be growing a little bit. It might coming down, but still growing. And this will probably become one of the bright spots in the global economy next year. But there will be some spots in this region that having difficulty like Sri Lanka, Pakistan, Bangladesh, Laos, Myanmar, right? So, okay. Got it, right? They said, okay. Now, let me show you the number in terms of manufacturing, the PMI index. US coming down, right? Let me show you. And then EU also coming down. UK coming down. China also coming down. What is this telling you? It's telling you that now, compared to 2 years ago, all the country is now enter into a new phase. Totally different. Different. Before, it's very active after COVID. But now, all major economy is now entering into a declining mode. And that will be having much implication to the trade, investment, and also in terms of investing. Another thing is brewing. Emerging market is also having difficulties. This is the estimate maybe 2 months ago of where will be the problem, which country will default. If you read the World Economic Outlook by the IMF last night, it will say that now 25% of emerging market is now either default or under bond distress. 25%, one-fourth. And in fact, they're saying that for the low-income country, 60% is already in default or under bond distress. 60%. What this means is the following. This is not the beginning, the end yet. This is just the beginning of the crisis. 60% of the low end is already going under. 25% of emerging market is already having problem, right? So you will expect to see that as time pass by over the next year, you start to see news like Sri Lanka spreading to other places like Pakistan, Bangladesh, even Laos, Laos, next to Thailand, right? El Salvador, and Ghana, Zambia, Turkey, Egypt. This is just the beginning of the challenge. And this is the number from IMF. IMF is the emergency room for emerging market. When this country went into difficulties, usually they will go to IMF asking for money. This is the total money that IMF have been lending at this point in time. All time high. And in fact, when you are thinking that if you fast forward by 12 months, 24 months, this number likely to grow substantially. Because we have a lot of clients waiting in the front of the hospital, right? So they will start to come in asking for money, and then we have to help them. So this is not a good time. I think this is quite challenging time. And Sri Lanka is just only the beginning. You will see other countries like this. In fact, when you look at the news, maybe not this picture yet,
But this picture is everywhere at this point in time. People struggle with high cost of living, high cost of energy, and also high inflation, strong dollars. They have difficulty living. There will be a lot of hunger. And when the country went into currency crisis, then you have even more problem later on. So this is two questions that you have to ask yourself. How can we pass through the volatilities and the new challenges from the perfect storm? How can we prepare for the new normal and the next chapter? Why? Because we cannot wait until the end of the crisis and prepare for the next chapter, right? We should do it now. Use these 2 or 3 years, prepare ourselves. The same thing like COVID. We can hide from COVID in our home, right? But at the same time, we also need to develop our digital capabilities. It's a great time, the best time to do digital adoption. And this is exactly the same thing. Crisis will always end. You have to prepare now. You have to do investment now. And you have to compete in the next chapter will be even more intense compared to these years. Let me give you the idea. If you would like to prepare for the crisis, we have to know how it will unfold, right? If I come and talk to you 9 months ago, I will probably don't see much of the futures. But now, from what been happening by the Fed, by all the action and everything, I think the picture start to emerge. You can see the glimpse of what will be happening over the next couple years. The crisis will have 4 phases. Phase 1 already completed, the exit of the investor that you have seen already, right? Those who invest with the bull market already left the market. The one who are in the market now are the one who love to surf with the volatilities. So this is professional. But the novice already gone, already died from the market. The second phase already begin. The Fed have been increasing the policy rate for maybe 6 months already. They said they already completed the first phase. Now they enter into the new restrictive zone, the lowest level, and the Fed chairman said ways to go. So basically you should expect that the Fed would increase interest rate at least until mid of next year, or maybe end of next year. They might start to decline from 0.75 to 0.5, 0.25. But let me warn you, I have seen the Fed raise interest rate in the year 2006, 2007. They increased 0.25, small, right, compared now, 0.75, but increased 0.25 for almost 16 times. 16 times consecutive, a total of 4% in 2 years. So basically, when the Fed come down to 0.25, don't celebrate, right? It only means that they feel that they have reached to a good zone. And from there on, they can keep on steadily at the right pace afterward. But they can keep on going until they feel that inflation coming down. And that can be not early next year, like people talking about, but we will mid of the year or maybe even end of the year. And by that time, inflation will start to come down already and recession will probably set in by mid of next year. And once recession set in, we enter into the third phase. Recession usually take three quarters, and I can show you later that sometimes it can take longer. I would expect that recession this time will complete it by the end of 2025, roughly about a year. And during that time, you will probably have emerging market crisis that brewing up at this point in time. And with these two crises together, inflation will come down because the houses has been burned already, right? So inflation will subside and come back to normal, and we will start the new phase where the Fed will start to stimulate economy again, and it will complete the cycle. This is the picture I want you to have in mind. Then why? Because then we can think exactly what to do, where are the difficulties in each, and what timing, right? Now, the question that people ask more, the depth and the length of the recessions. Let me show you. We have something called global recessions. And global recessions only happened 4 times over the past 70 years. 4 times. That's it. Global recession means that you have recession at the same time many places around the world. Many places around the world. Usually you have recession in US, but China doing well. Europe doing well, right? Sometimes you have problem in Europe, US doing well. But this will be the time when everyone enter into recession at the same time. At the same time. And the reason is that they are fighting the same war, the war with inflation, and they're using the same medicine, increasing interest rate, and they have the same philosophy. They want to making sure that inflation will coming down, right? At all costs. At all costs means that will come. If you have recession, it's okay to me, right? This is the central bankers talking. So basically, they will do the best they can to get inflation down. And in fact, the Fed chairman have been talking about 1970 experience of Paul Volcker and the Fed when they stopped too early. They see inflation coming down, so they said, okay, now recession is underway, everything should be okay. So they start lower the rate. And as a result, inflation come up again. So it means that if they keep on talking about these lessons, it means only one thing. They will not stop until they are certain that inflation will be finished. And as a result, I'm very confident, because I used to be central banker for 14 years. I know how they think. They have to get the job done, right? As a result, everyone have to prepare for the repercussion, recession that will be start popping up in many places around the world. And when we have this global recession, we have it only in 1997, 1982. This is oil shock, like this time, energy shock, right? 1991, 2009, because global financial crisis. But let me show you the length of the recessions. 3 quarters, roughly. This is roughly about 5 quarters, 15 months. But look at the number, right? That is the year 1973 to 75, 81 to 82, and 2009, right? Exactly the same number. So what it means is when you have a global recession, it is hard to come out. It is hard to come out. It will take time. Take time. So basically, I would like to tell you that you should prepare for quite a lengthy recession. Not a shallow, not a short one, but a lengthy one. And in fact, the depth, how deep the recession will go, will depend on these factors. The real estate market in the US and in China will be very important factors. Let me show you some numbers. US home sale have been around 1 million per year. But lately, 400,000, 500,000 by half. New home supply, which used to be roughly about 3 months, now is at 11 months. And 11 months is exactly the same level at the peak of subprime. What does that mean? It means that people in America have difficulty selling home, and the home that already built is already 11 months supply. No more reason to build, right? But residential investment is 17% of GDP of America. It's quite large. So it means that this main sector with a long supply chain will not function well over the next couple of years. And this will make the recession that we see deeper than what we thought. And this is not in the model. And in fact, look at this picture. I heard the Fed chairman say that before, 2 or 3 months before, someone selling the house, they said 10% more. No need to see the house. I just buy it, right? They're just afraid someone will take it. 10% more now. You know what happened now? This is the picture that have been happening everywhere in America. Price reduce, price reduction on sale. And in fact, the price will be coming down substantially because of QE have been raising the price substantially. This is the home price in America going up. This is the peak of the subprime. This is the bubble, right? It's coming down 30%, take 5 years to come back to the same place. And then after COVID hit, it increased 50% in 2 years, from 200 to 305 in 2 years. This is the impact of low interest rate and QE. What does this mean? It means what go up will come down, right? And when it come down, it will hurt people. And when it come down deeply, it will make recession deeper. And in fact, the real estate crisis is not only in the US. In China, it's also having problem. Let me show you another company. You have heard about Evergrande last year, right? Roughly about 12 months ago, Evergrande ran into problem. But I think Evergrande is old news. No need to talk about Evergrande because Evergrande is number 14. Let's talk about number one in China, Country Garden. The stock price of Country Garden coming down from 18 to roughly 10 last year. And now it's staying at 2.36. 80% reduction in 1 year. And in fact, the price of the corporate bond issued by Country Garden, which used to be around 100, has been selling at 30 at one time. From 100, usually you have to have 105, right? With interest rate. Yet you're selling it at 30, and now it's recovered to 50s. But 50 is still nothing, right? So basically it means that people not confident enough to give money to this developer. And if number one developer in China cannot have access into capital market, what would happen to the rest of the real estate sector in China? And this means big problem, because if American real estate sector is maybe 17 to 20%, in China, 35%. And this means China will have major problem to resolve. And usually when enter into this problem, economy will grow slowly for some time. This is normal for me. As an economist, every economy run into crisis. All economy, Thailand, couple time already. I remember Rachang Ngan Thun, and then when we have the Tom Yam Kung crisis, right? But every country went into some difficulties, and they have to resolve it and get out. But it means during this difficult time, when every country in around the world enter into recession, China, which used to be the place where we send the product to, right? During subprime, we sent to China. During COVID, half of the brand name selling in China. But now China have its own problem. China cannot receive anything anymore. And in fact, the worst thing that can happen is that product that produced in China will start to come out and then enter into all the market and compete in the third market with us next year. That will be also another difficulties. But then, look at this. This is the country of order, right? But people said, I cannot take it anymore. You take my money, but you don't build. How can that be? And I already borrow from the bank and give you all my money, but you don't build my home. So they start having a protest. starting from one places, now it's everywhere in China. It's not only one province, but it's all the provinces. So this is quite challenging. But let me tell you, now good news, right? I spend half my time on bad news. Now let me give you some good news. Otherwise, this seminar having problem. Okay. When you have bad crisis, there will be great opportunities. Let me show you some pictures. This is all the bear market, but it's always followed by the bull market, right? See, every time you have difficulties in the market, once you clean it up, then the recovery has been quite strong. Look at the number. This is from all episodes of the bear market. Usually it dropped by 35%, 37%, right? But now NASDAQ is 30%, so almost there, a little bit more. But look at 12 months after the bear market end, you have 50% return. This is quite good, right? That's exactly why I'm telling you, with bad crisis will be great opportunities. But the main question is that you have to have the money in your pocket, right? You don't invest too early, right? Remember, Kovsak said, don't invest too early. If you want to invest now, invest a little bit to keep yourself patient. And then when the right time comes, you should enter into the market, and then you will have very exciting return. Now, also, with adequate preparation, company-wise, people, and also country, we should be able to weather the coming challenges. I think Thailand will do quite well in this crisis. We're making a preparation at this point in time, but I think we should do okay. I'm working at the bank, so I've been working with my clients, but I also helping the government. We are also making some preparations. Now, let me talk about the next chapter in the time remaining. I think once we finish with the transition phase 2 or 3 years from now, we will enter into the next chapters. And this next chapter will have a different set of challenges. Because before, we have been working to keep our business running and surviving COVID-19. Remember, the past 2 years has been quite tough to everyone, right? How can we survive? How can we get enough liquidities? Now, we will enter into a new set of challenge, a world with geopolitics, a world with technological disruption, and also a world where Asian century starting. Let me now cover some of this topic in detail. The problem of geopolitics is coming from these pictures. This is the true cause of the whole thing. You wondering why there was a conflict in Europe, why there's conflict in Asia and other places, right? But Ray Dalio paint these pictures. You can see that there is rise and fall of empire from China to the Viking, Netherlands, to the British, to American, and now the re-emergence of China again. If this trend continues, you will start to see China become number one in the world. But every time the power change hand from number one to number two, there is always conflict. Because number one never let it go. They will do everything they can, right? And this is probably the last window that they can do something. Time is running out. Because they see this number. The size of China compared to US have changed drastically over the past 50 years from 10% to 75%. In terms of PPP, in fact, China will surpassing US quite soon. So it means that now China will be really, in a sense, become number one economy in the world. This is unacceptable, right? For number one. And that's exactly why they have to do something. In terms of technology, this number is also ring an alarm. China is already have patent more than America and more than Japan. But this is just the beginning from China, right? They're just starting enter into R&D. But they already surpassing America and surpassing Japan. And if you let this continue for 5 years, 10 years, 20 years, what will happen? That is the question, right? And that's exactly no wonder why we see this thing happening. We thought that we change from President Trump to Biden, everything will be better, right? But in fact, no, you have another trade war continue, but in different form. Nice talk, nice word, but exactly the same confrontation. Why? I ask myself, the reason is definitely because company in America cannot accept this. They have to let their government making sure that this is cannot continue, right? So as a result, technological war have been happening. Sanction in terms of technology continue until today. And in fact, you have to ask yourself why? Why during this difficult time, you have to go to Taiwan. Let me say this. We have difficult time already, right? Economy is not doing so well. Recession is ahead. Why we need one more problem? Perfect storm is already big, right? We don't need category 10. I just don't know what to say. But look at this. This is really. But for me, this is the reflection of the conflict. You have been overtaken by, well, going to be overtaken. So you have to do something, right? And in fact, when you look at all these things together, some general from Ukraine said the war will not finish, not by the end of these years. And in fact, the head of the NATO came out and said that Ukraine war will last for years, not just the end of this year, right now, for years. And thinking about that, right? There are reasons to these things. Why you have to fight so much with Russia? The answer is that Russia also becoming the threat to America over the past couple of years. If you remember Boris Yeltsin, right? At that time, Russia is in decline. Roughly 2% of the size of America. From before, roughly about 60%. During Cold War, 60%, coming down to 2%. But under Putin, he take it up to 14% again. 14%. And he decided to annex Crimea in 2014. But look at this. This is the picture that the general have in mind. Before the annexation, after sanction is coming down, right? Everything, the GDP coming down. And by the end of 6 years, GDP of Russia is 20% down. And in fact, when you compare the size of the economy, from 14% of US is now roughly about 7%, reduced by half. In terms of military, this picture has a lot of implication. You cannot build an army without money, right? If you are small, if you are the size of Texas, you cannot fight with America, with partner. And now, with the war with Ukraine, why all the sanction? Have you asked yourself why all the sanction on Russia, right? The answer is that because they want to making sure that after this war ended or coming down, Russia will be in a bad shape in terms of economy. And in fact, they would like the size of Russia to come down even further. Why the war have to drag on? Why big country cannot finish with small country in 3 weeks? Answer is that because NATO would like to take these opportunities to destroy all the equipment that Russia have, right? After you destroy it, with smaller size of economy, no money, right? And with no money, you cannot build up a new army. And by everything finished, then you only have China and US confront with each other. That is the key. But you never know what will happen, right? Because things can happen when you keep on doing these things. Russia sent some rocket into this nuclear power plant, one of the biggest in Ukraine. So accidents can happen. But all of these things, what are the consequences? I think 2022 is the turning point of the global economy from globalization. Now you will have a fragmented world economy, quite fragmented. In terms of trade, definitely now you don't trade with Russia. Later on, maybe you won't trade with China, but I don't know what will happen because we produce everything in China, right? And technology, you said Russia cannot use American technology, and you also said China cannot take American technology either. So how will the world look like? I mean, in the old time, everyone shared the knowledge, work together and solve the problem. Now you have Russian technology, Chinese technology, American technology. And that will be also a fragmented world. In terms of investment, you've seen people divesting from Russia. You see China divesting from America in preparation. And people also taking the company out of China at this point in time. Relocation outside, right? Payment system. This is exactly what they've been working on. Russia, China, India, others. Now they try to have their own payment system. And in fact, this will all together making the world economy to become more fragmented, suboptimal. And also, there are some possibilities of more direct confrontation later on, which I think will be your challenge for the futures. And if you ask me, I don't see this thing going away. Only get worse. The second thing, technological disruption. This will be also very important. In Thai, they will say, "Bun kao, kamlang cha pai lao." It means that our traditional company will probably be gone in the future, right? You would not imagine that, car, now we have EV, internal combustion will be gone. Hard disk drive probably gone soon. Steel probably have some replacement. Energy probably also have some replacement, solar. And even food. You wouldn't believe that food can be produced in the lab now, right? Normal food will be changed also, like you never think before. So basically, world will be changing over the next couple years. And in fact, next couple decades. Someone told me, over the past 20 years, technological innovation that we discover is more than 2,000 years combined. And over the next 20 years, it will be even more than now. And as a result, you have this new startup coming up everywhere, right? And the digital revolution, I go very quickly now, all the possibilities in front of us. This is the old mode. The new one. look very clean, right? No people. Only robot. Now you can see that in the factory is zero people. Robot is now very cute, talking and then dancing. Just the beginning. And AI technology is coming very strong. This is for traffic control by Alibaba. And then this is by Huawei, public safety. And also the sensor is everywhere. Really change the way we manage things. And this is also very interesting picture. Usually we can use AI to help detect cancers. The doctor say the following. The doctor say that, well, I'm still better than AI. They said AI is making a mistake by 8%. And the doctor is 3.5%, right? But in fact, it's not the competition, but the use of the AI to augment it to the doctor. Now, together the working, the doctor with AI, only 0.5% miss the diagnosis. That's very important. And that's exactly why this digital revolution changed the way we deal with things, increasing the efficiency, and things are really changing. Maybe people still skeptical about metaverse, but it will coming. I can see it. It really, really will change the world later on. Now, the company that failed to adapt to changes and failed to harness the power of technology and digital will disappear. Look at Kodak, right? Nokia, and many other companies. Finally, the Asian centuries is also upon us. By mid of these centuries, the size of Asia in the world economy will be more than half. And that's have a lot of consequence. And in fact, this is the number by Nikkei. Asia have almost 1,000 billionaires. And our number are the region. What does that mean? It means that all the riches of the world is here in Asia. And Asia only beginning. Then later on, all the purchasing power will be in Asia. And as a result, this will be great for ASEAN. This will be great for Thailand. You know why? Because this is the picture of some of the cities in Thailand in the past, Nakhon Si Thammarat. All the cities is like this, usually have four doors, north, south, east, west, right? Asia also have four doors. Russia, China, India, and ASEAN. Now, this door is completely closed. No one enter anymore, right? China is closing very fast. India loves to talk to Russia and love to buy oil from Russia and talk to China, right? So basically the West probably he is their friend. And if that is the case, what is all this mean? It means that out of these four doors, there's only one door left to get into Asia, right? Which is ASEAN. And that will have big implication, very big implication. The reason why, because you have all the billionaire here, but if you have to produce in America, you have to produce in Europe, shipping costs will be very high, not competitive. You have to be in Asia somewhere so that you can serve this market, even though you don't want to be in their country, right? So basically, at the end, there's no choice. They have to come here to produce here and serve the whole Asia under these scenarios. And that will be a great thing for Thailand. That's exactly why we start to see a lot of projects coming up. A lot of projects coming up. One more minute. and then VYD, the biggest EV company in China also choosing Thailand, right? There will be many more. So I think at the end, you will see ASEAN during these couple years become the hot, the crossroad of all companies. And that will be great for us to withstand the perfect storm. The question is, how can we capture these opportunities, right? The Thai government is now thinking about regional headquarters, R&D center, logistic hub, new S-curve startup, all the projects in EEC area, S-curve, and climbing the technology ladder. New CBD, I can tell you, 5 years from now, Bangkok will change. Beautiful CBDs. The owner having problem because they will be competing low cost, right? Good for headquarters. And one Bangkok, Central Dusit, Makassan area, Bang Sue, Asia Teak. Subway will all be completed, 10 lines. And double track train will be completed. Connectivities with the rest of the regions, with China, with India, with ASEAN will be completed. And in fact, if we can do one more project, the Western Gateway, if we can open it here, we already have a small one in Ranong. If we can do it now, it will change the competitiveness because this has been very congested. If you have to send product from Ram Chabang, go down there, take maybe 3 weeks. But if we can send from Ranong, it will take only 4 days, 7 days. That will be very important because if we can open this seaport, all the product from Western China will come down and try to use this seaport to go out. And that's exactly why. And the government is also working on another project to bring in global talent, like Agoda, that we already have 1,000 technicians working on one company. So, my ending, as I told you before, crisis always faded away. And this time will be probably 3 years. So you have to use this time very well because the challenge of the next chapter is very immense. If you prepare later, you will not be adequate. So you take your time during these difficult times and prepare yourself. You will emerge victoriously. Thank you.